like to go ahead and focus completely on the fact that today is Sanctity of Life Sunday. How many of you knew that before you came? Okay, thank you. And the reason for that, the reason for the timing is because of the timing of a decision made in our nation many years ago. But before I talk about that, I just want to read to you the three verses from the very first chapter of the Bible. And these three verses are referred to by Jesus over and over. They're referred to by Paul. They're referred to over and over in the scripture. We're told to go back to the beginning, go back to the foundational truths. And here's what it says. Then God said, "Let us make man in our image, according to our likeness, and let them rule over the fish of the sea, and over the birds of the sky, and over the cattle, and over the earth, and over every creeping thing that creeps on the earth." God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created him. Male and female, he created them. God blessed them. And God said to them, "Be fruitful and multiply and fill the earth and subdue it and rule over the fish of the sea and over the birds of the sky and over every living thing that moves on the earth." Now, in those few verses, there are several things that are mentioned. The one that we're highlighting is the fact that we were created in the image of God. You'll notice that even though the Bible teaches there's one God, the plural is used there. Let us make God in our, or make man in our image. And we see the fellowship in the Trinity there. You know, the fact that God is God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Or many have commented on the fact that we see that in these verses, but the thing is that it says that we are created in the image of God. But I want you to notice, these are the verses that Jesus always goes back to when he talks about marriage. These verses, actually, I want to point out four things that these verses talk about. Number one, the sanctity of life. We're made in God's image. The Bible doesn't say that about any other creation. Number two, it says that God created man, and then what's the next statement? Male and female, he created them. It talks about the sanctity of human life. It talks about the sanctity of our sexuality. It talks about the sanctity of marriage in the sense that the very first command that God says, he says, be fruitful and multiply. And then he says, take dominion over the earth. The sanctity of our relationship to the world. And I want to just mention, in these three verses, there are four essential teachings that are being assaulted in our culture today. All of them. All of them very basic to who we are, and they are all under attack in our culture today. The sanctity of human life is the first one, the importance of human life. Our sexuality, the importance of marriage, and the relationship that we have to the rest of creation. Or let me put it this way, the relationship that we have to our environment. I don't know if everybody is aware of how there is such a strong, powerful environmental movement, even to the point, I've shared some writings with you before, some quotes, where some environmentalists believe that for the sake of Mother Earth, at least 30% of the human population needs to be eliminated. That's actually being written in books and recommended as a goal to try to accomplish. And so those four basic things are all wrapped up in these three verses. The sanctity of human life, the sanctity of our sexuality, the sanctity of marriage, and the sanctity of our role in the rest of God's creation. Now, I did not put this PowerPoint together. I came across this as I was thinking about this day. And so I want us just to go through it together. The next, hopefully the computer's going to cooperate with us. Or not. Turn in your Bible to Psalm 139. I want to read this verse to you. Psalm 139. There it is. Go ahead and leave it there for just a second. I want you to go ahead and take a look at this little picture. This is an actual picture of a human baby in the womb. It's a little face. And the principle that we're talking about is Scripture teaches that human life is sacred. Human life is sacred. And Psalm 139, verse 13, if you'll look at that in your Bible, and I think that's what the next screen is, it says this: "For you formed my inward parts. You wove me," where?
In my mother's womb.
Specifically, Psalm 139 tells us that God designed us. He wove me. I mean, how many of you have ever woven anything? I remember when I was a little kid, they taught us how to do a certain type of weaving, make a little rug, you know, and weaving is complicated. You got to do it just right. You got to make it all fit together. And this is one of the things that you've heard me go on and on about, because the idea that there are people called scientists who actually believe that we are the result of random chance and time is just absolutely astounding, because there is nothing more complicated in design, more intelligent in design than the human body, and more than the human body, the life that we have. Do you understand that science is still unable to explain the consciousness that you have right now? You are aware of me. You're looking at me. You're listening to me. You're responding with thoughts. You're thinking either positively or negatively or all kinds of different ambient thoughts that come with every single thing that happens right here. Some of you might be thinking of something else, and I'm trying to get your attention back here. The fact is, you have an individual being that resides within your body that is so amazingly complex, but the fact that you are self-aware and alive, we can't explain it. Life is a gift that we cannot fully comprehend. We know how to end it. In fact, we have become experts at ending life. But we cannot create life. We cannot even fully understand. Science doesn't even agree on what life is. There are some scientists who believe that you are nothing more than just a huge conglomeration of chemical reactions inside your brain. That your awareness is actually just the appearance of awareness. Now, how you can just appear to be aware and aware that you're just a peer of being awareing, I'm not aware of how that could be. But the fact is that we are a creation of God, and that creation is a sacred thing. And God says that it begins in the mother's womb. We are knit together in our mother's womb. And this basic, I've already listed four different things, but let's go ahead and focus in on the sanctity of human life and understand that this is a foundation. It's interesting because if you go to the next frame here, our computer is so slow. It's amazing.
Well, you're lucky it's even playing.
The next frame says, "Sanctity of human life is a foundation providing guidance regarding how we treat each other." Now, when I first read that phrase, "Sanctity of human life is a foundation," my mind immediately went to the fact that Optimal Hospice, who I work for, we have a foundation. When we talk about a foundation, a lot of times we're talking about a human organization that we put together to try to accomplish some purpose. That's not what this is talking about, but the thing is, it communicates the same idea. A foundation always has a desired purpose. And when you think of foundation in this sense, it actually is a reference to a foundation like a foundation for a building. But when you lay a foundation, how many of you have ever worked in construction? All right, how important is a foundation?
Very.
Why is that so important?
Everything depends on it.
Everything depends on the foundation. Everything else is resting on the foundation. And so you can have a sound structure, but if it's not on a good foundation, if it's not connected properly to the foundation, the whole thing can come apart. This picture is used over and over in Scripture. And we know that the foundation of the church in terms of persons, there's only one person. The foundation of the church is who? Is Christ Jesus. In terms of teaching, the Bible says that the foundation of the church is the apostle and prophets. In other words, the Old and New Testament. In terms of teaching, we have the Word of God. But in terms of understanding and principles and ideas, these verses that we've read in Genesis 1, like I said, Jesus always referred back to them. Paul always referred back to them. These are foundational teachings that have to do with our whole attitude towards life and towards what it means to be human and towards other human beings. And so when we say the sanctity of human life is a foundation, providing guidance regarding how we treat others, stop and think, what those verses that we just read about God creating man in his own image, what does that say about our relationship to other people then? Tell me a truth that's based on those foundational principles. Tell me something that applies to our relationship with other people.
You mean a verse?
No, just a thought. If it's true that God created mankind in his own image, then every person is what?
In the image of
God. In the image of God? What else? I mean, make an application. What was the word you just said, Pastor?
Valuable.
Valuable? I think someone said sacred. Let me suggest that the very understanding of human worth is tied up in these verses. When you abandon the idea that we are created in the image of God, the idea of human worth dissipates and goes away. The idea of human purpose dissipates and goes away. The idea of human dignity dissipates and goes away. In fact, the idea of human responsibility dissipates and go away. Can you think of anything that's happened in the news in the last few years that would indicate that somehow at the very core of our culture we have lost a sense of worth and purpose, and dignity, and responsibility? Have you been amazed at how irresponsible some people can be living their lives? And we wonder, in fact, I can't even count the number of times that it seems like we ask ourselves, how could they do that? But when your sense of worth and purpose and dignity and responsibility are stripped away, in other words, when the foundation is not there, all the rest of the structure can crumble. Let me suggest to you, and here is the reason for the choice of the third Sunday in January being Sanctity of Human Life Sunday. On January 22nd, 1973, that foundation of how we view ourselves and how we treat other people was cracked and was broken. Go to the next frame, there we go. On January 22nd, 1973, a Supreme Court decision that was made that we know as Roe v. Wade. And Roe v. Wade repealed all state laws prohibiting abortion. All state laws were repealed by our Supreme Court in Roe v. Wade. Not as well known. I've heard of this several times, but it didn't just pop to my mind the way that Roe v. Wade does, but Doe v. Bolton. How many of you have heard of that? Okay? Doe v. Bolton was a decision made at the same time that extended the right to abortion to the entire 9 months of pregnancy. And let's go ahead to this next picture. This is a picture of the sitting Supreme Court at that time, if we can get to it. One more.
Back?
No, one more forward in the process. There's a picture of the Supreme Court. Anyway, we'll get to it. It'll catch up in a minute.
There they go.
All right, there they are. As you know, our Supreme Court is made up of 9 people, and in 1973, 7 out of the 9 made a decision. Count, 7 people. This is why, as they say, elections have consequences. Elections are so important in our country. This is one of the branches of government that is supposed to be in balance checking. You've heard checks and balances. You know, that's one of the things that we've been so upset about recently, because it seems like the executive branch of government has been able to function and to legislate on its own. And by the way, just because the other party is in power does not mean that we should have the attitude that it's okay now if the administrative branch is able to legislate. Does everybody understand what that means? Administrative, that's the president. And an administer is someone who is supposed to administer the laws that are already in place. But we've had a president who has been legislating from the White House. The problem is that when the Supreme Court legislates from the Supreme Court, that's not according to our law either. Our legislature is made up of a lot of people who are supposed to represent who?
The people.
And the legislature, as we read from several months ago, I read from the Constitution, and the very first statement of the Constitution is that the legislature is the only ones who get to make law. The president doesn't get to make law. The Supreme Court doesn't get to make law. But in 1973, 7 men decided that human life did not begin until after birth. They made that decision, and it has had an impact upon our nation that's been tremendous. Not only did Roe v. Wade repeal all state laws prohibiting abortion, Roe v. Wade made abortion legal in all 50 states as a result, and the states could only apply restrictions in the last 3 months of pregnancy unless the life or, quote, health of the mother was at stake. The only problem is that Doe v. Bolton defined health as all factors, physical, emotional, psychological, familial, and pertaining to a woman's age. What does that mean? It meant that basically, on the basis of health, abortion for any reason throughout all 9 months of pregnancy was legal in all 50 states. And the aftermath of that decision, this is what is happening according, go ahead to the next frame if you would. It's okay if you try to be ahead of me, Don, because it's taken so long. We've covered that. Okay, here we go. Well, I'm sorry, go through all that. We've covered that. What I want you to see is some based on the statistics from Planned Parenthood. Planned Parenthood, right-wing organization? No. Planned Parenthood is the number one provider of abortion in all of America. Go ahead to the next one. That's where we're trying to get to. Okay, go ahead. We're still behind. Why do so many women have abortions? Here are the reasons, according to family planning perspectives. Go ahead, go through the reasons. Convenience is the number one reason for abortion when it comes to abortion in America. Convenience. Financial concerns. Can I just ask you when did the financial concerns come into your consideration in your family? The financial concerns need to be considered prior. The financial concerns need to be considered before not only a couple engages in sex, but before a couple becomes married. That's part of the preparation. We're living in a time where people believe that the highest value is to fulfill our desires and nothing else matters. Whereas it used to be a generally understood policy of life is that you plan ahead. You plan ahead. You make responsible decisions. And the problem is that even relationship problems, say a young couple, well, we're not getting along too well, so the baby needs to die. Well, we're awfully young, so the baby needs to die. Well, we're not married yet, so the baby needs to die. There are all kinds of reasons in this culture today where an innocent life, the baby, needs to die. And that is because we have abandoned the teaching of the scripture. Since January 22, 1973, 57 million babies have been denied the right to life. Go ahead to the next one. Each point is a different frame. 57 million. I meant to look up and determine what country that's, you know, anybody have any idea of a country this, with 57 million people? That's the size of a small country. The reality is that, go ahead to the next one. We'll stop on that for just a second because I didn't make that statement. So many women are choosing abortion. The reasons listed, convenience, financial concerns, relationship problems, being young and unmarried. But the reality is that sometimes a woman feels completely alone. What the name of an organization right here in town that has answered and addressed this issue for so many is the CYM organization. I never can remember exactly. CYM stands for Christian
Community Youth Ministries.
Say it again?
It used to be Christian Youth Ministries, and now it's Community.
Okay. But this is something that we support, and there are pregnancy centers all across America that are addressing these issues. But the reality is that this is a ministry where the church needs to pray and needs to be available to support women because oftentimes they feel alone in facing these situations. And we've had young women come and speak to our church about how it's made all the difference in the world. And I want to encourage us to continue to support this ministry and also to consider the fact is that maybe some of the folks in our church who are not already involved in volunteering for ministries to consider looking into that one, because you cannot come closer to the most foundational basic teachings that affect everything else in our lives. So I want to talk about just for a moment a time to repair the foundation. Genesis 1:1, the fact that God has created us in His image is the foundational truth to everything else that we teach in the scripture. If that's not true, nothing else is true. And the reality is that that teaching affects everything else in our lives. And so the time to repair the foundation needs to begin with a recognition that all human life is sacred. Move on to time to repair the foundation. We're way behind again. Recognize that all human life is sacred. I shared with you that a few weeks ago I said that the Bible talks about signs and wonders, and I believe in that, absolutely. But in these days, there's science and wonders too. And if it's amazing the things that we're learning through science and technology. And some of the things that we're learning about little unborn babies in the womb, the heart starts beating at 21 days. 21 days. How many weeks is that?
3 weeks.
3 weeks. 3 weeks. The heart begins to beat at 3 weeks old. The eyes begin to develop by the fourth week. At 6 weeks, the baby hiccups. The baby hiccups and moves spontaneously in the womb. There was a video that was produced called The Silent Scream. Now, it was considered to be in poor taste, and people are discouraged from watching this video because it's in such poor taste. And what it does is it tells the truth about the fact that in the process of abortion, babies respond in pain from a very early point. I don't have the specific weeks at this point, but very early on, the idea of abortion is presented to young women as though it's just the removal of a blob of tissue. But in fact, these babies are formed in the womb very early, and they respond in pain to the abortions that are performed. And so what we need to do is realize that our culture needs to abandon this idea that little babies are something to be used and decided about according to our convenience, and recognize that in the womb, every single person is God's masterpiece. I want you to write that down. Each person is a masterpiece. If that attitude is in our lives, it doesn't just change our attitude about abortion, it changes our attitude about life, it changes our attitude about relationships. Why are there so many circumstances when we actually see on video young people treating other people as though they absolutely have no worth? How long has it been? In fact, how long is it between each new instance of where some video goes viral of some young person beating up or demeaning or even sometimes killing someone else as though they had absolutely no purpose? I mean, it wasn't that long ago that snuff videos, how many of you know what a snuff video is? The popularity of snuff videos began to grow dynamically. A snuff video is a video of someone actually, literally, really being killed. And there is a whole area in which those are available to people, and their popularity is amazing. It's unbelievable how many people find some sort of sense of entertainment in that behavior. How can that be? Because we have abandoned the foundational understanding that human life is sacred. Every human life is sacred. Each person is a masterpiece. And so today needs to be seen as a new day. There may be tremendous hope for some change in our country, and we need to be praying for it. We need to be praying for it. There is tremendous hope that the texture of our Supreme Court is changing. So I want to encourage you. The very first thing that's on this list is volunteer. And there may be some right here that could volunteer with the CYM, volunteer with a birth organization that helps young women who have decided to keep their baby. There may be a time in which we as a church can support a young woman in this community as she considers keeping her baby. But the fact is that we need to volunteer, pray, donate, and become involved in supporting the sacredness of human life. And let others know. Let others know that that's where we stand. The fact is that the pro-life attitude is growing in our country again. And we need to realize that is an absolute necessity. As far as speaking the truth about the gospel, as far as maintaining the humanity of our culture. And so I want to encourage you to decide today to defend, protect, and value all innocent human life. And I'm going to just drop that word innocent, because the fact is that every baby in the womb is an innocent life. And we need to value every innocent life, but we need to value all human life. The fact is that we have lost as a culture our the sacredness of human life after birth as well. It's all connected, it's foundational, and we need to recognize that the gospel is a message of life. Turn in your Bibles to John chapter 10. John chapter 10, verse 10. John 10:10, one of the memory verses that I learned when I was a teenager, and this is a verse that we would use to share the gospel, but this is a verse that Jesus explains his whole purpose. He said, "The thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy. I came that they may have life and have it abundantly." Jesus came to give life. Life is sacred. Life is what God is all about. Life is what the gospel is about. And you might think that the message of pro-life, anti-abortion, whatever you label it, you might think that that is somehow not attached to the message of the gospel. But they are absolutely connected. They are absolutely connected. And every relationship, every person that we relate to, our attitude towards life, if we recognize that every life is sacred, every life is given by God, every life is valuable, then it's not only going to affect our attitudes about abortion, but it's going to affect our attitudes about the gospel. It's going to affect our attitudes about how we communicate, how we treat, how we interact with other people. And so I want to encourage you, let's pray, let's ask God that He could move our nation back to the point where we recognize what does the scripture says, or excuse me, what does our founding documents say, that we know that we are endowed by our Creator with life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. Those rights are given to us by our Creator. That's the foundation of our country, and we need to pray that God can return us to that. Would you stand with me, and let's close in a word of prayer. Father, thank you for this day that has been set aside to recognize the sanctity of human life. Father, thank you for the fact that you created us, gave us this life, you value us, you have determined, God, that all of creation is to be directed by us, humanity. And Lord, that even as our relationship to our creation, our relationship in marriage, our relationship sexually, our relationship just in terms of worth is being challenged in this day, Father, we pray that you would help us to stand for truth and communicate your